Good morning, my dear future chartered accountants. I hope everybody is doing great. Can you please confirm first that my voice is audible and the PPT is visible? Okay. So we are doing the upgradation classes, and this is regarding the consolidation piece. Application problems, like what do you mean by control, what are the exemptions, and what are the what do you mean by investment entity, when the control exists, when the power exists, those kind of theoretical aspects we have discussed till yesterday. Now we are going to look at the problems, and before that I requested you to look at the my system of solving consolidation. It's already available in my YouTube channel. Please make sure you watch that before looking at these problems. You can look at RPL revision lectures, where I have done the format discussion along with the logic, which I'm not doing it now. I'm going for the problem straight away. And one more reminder, these questions are available in the format. These questions, that is the new study material questions, RTP, MTP questions, and Census Analysis questions. I've compiled it. It's available then for these sessions, the PDF format. I've shared in my Telegram channel at chinmayhegde. Please make sure you download the material and use that as a reference for these classes. Let's go for the problems now. Hope you have the material with you. Okay, good. So let us do this problem now. Hope you got this question. Ram Limited acquires 60% of Raja Limited by paying cash consideration of 750 lakhs including control premium. The fair value of non-controlling interest on the date of acquisition is 480 lakhs. The value of subsidiary is identifiable, the value of subsidiary's net identifiable assets as per Ind AS 103 is rupees 1000 lakhs. Determine the value of goodwill and pass the journal entry. Goodwill can be computed in two methods. One is proportionate method, other is fair value method. And both are referenced to the basis on which NCI, non-controlling interest, is measured. If NCI is measured on proportionate basis, then it's called as proportionate method of goodwill. If NCI is measured on fair value basis, then it's called as fair value method of goodwill. So let's understand both the ways. First, let's understand proportionate method. Proportionate method. Okay. Again, I'm not discussing in detail regarding the process and all, but I will compute the numbers and like give you the logic behind it. But concept of discussion in detail from the basics, I'm not doing it. The format goes like this for proportionate method, or actually I can do it in a columnar method. Let me do it in a columnar method. One column I'll do for proportionate method. The other one I call it as fair value method. So format is very simple, in a numerical format. We are going to consider the purchase consideration, or I will say whatever the cost of investments, by holding company. So basically, this is the PC, purchase consideration. Paid by holding company. Purchase consideration paid by holding company. Then we are going to consider NCI, outsider shares, because this represents holding company share in subsidiary. Holding company is one of the shareholders. And then outsider share, that is called as NCI. NCI, non-controlling interest, outsider share basically. We will add both and then we will subtract. So this I will add. This will give me 100% valuation of the subsidiary company minus net identifiable asset, or I will say net assets taken over, net identifiable assets. Net identifiable assets. So balancing figure is called as goodwill. If negative answer comes, then we call it as capital reserve in our regular terms. Here we call it as gain on bargain purchase. Gain on bargain purchase. That is if it will get as a negative number in this format. Okay, so what is the cost of investments? Sometime company makes the payment, sometime they issue the shares. Cash consideration they pay 750 lakhs. So cost of investment, purchase consideration paid is 750 lakhs. Everything I'll make it as rupees lakhs. NCI, proportionate method. Okay, then look at what is net identifiable assets. Net identifiable asset is 1000 lakhs. So you write net identifiable assets, 1000 lakhs. This should be subtracted. So we have to value NCI in proportionate method. You take proportionate of net assets. NCI is calculated on proportionate of net assets. Net identifiable asset is 1000. Take proportionately 1000 into holding company share is a 60%. So NCI share will be 40%. So take 1000 into 40%, which is 400. So what is the goodwill comes to? 750 plus 400 minus 1000. Right? Yeah, 150. Okay. Observation here. When you follow proportionate method, why it is called as proportionate method? One, because NCI is measured as a percentage of net assets, net identifiable assets. That is one reason you can say. I'm getting one question. We students who took the classes from you always like to have an edge over others because you purchased from me, and others who are learning free from me on this, so you are losing, you feel you are losing edge. See, the method is there, but it's always important how you apply the methods, right? So you paid for me, not for the method, but for the practice you have done. We have done so many problems in the same method, right? That's what gives you confidence. And other person passed the exam, you also passed the exam. It's fine, right? No problem with that. As long as you clear the exams, whether the other person solved by similar method, different method, that's not going to have any impact. So what is important is this method, are you able to learn it properly? In fact, if there is a loser, the loser is me actually. Because people are learning free, where I have designed that method, I'm not getting the benefit of that. Right? But anyway, so let's not worry about the financial impact. Our focus is on learnings. For a regular student, I would have given about 200 plus hours. So for that effort, you have paid. So let's keep it very simple based on that. Method, I can give it for free, or any of my students also can teach. So the method is always available in plenty, knowledge always meant to be shared. Fine. Hope you take it in a positive manner. Okay. So why are we calling this as proportionate method? That is because one, we are valuing NCR on proportionate basis, and the second you look at the effective calculation we are doing. 1000 we are subtracting, 400 we are adding. Effectively, can I say that I am subtracting 600? And what is effectively 600? That is the holding company share of assets, right? 1000 is the subsidiary company's assets. 60% is the holding company share, which is comes to 600. So effectively, 150 is related to holding company share. In goodwill of subsidiary. So this 150 is effectively related to the holding company share of goodwill of subsidiary. Holding company share only. Holding company is the owner. Only proportionately to their ownership, what is the goodwill? Okay. Now coming to fair value methods. What is the difference going to be? 750. NCI is going to be not on proportionate basis. NCI is going to be on fair value basis. What is going to be fair value basis? The fair value of net tangible asset is 480 lakhs. So 480 lakhs. And net tangible asset, fair value of NCI is 480 lakhs. Net tangible asset is thousands. So in this case, how much goodwill comes to 750 plus 480 minus 1000? 230. You see, the amount is higher. Now, can you think why in this method the goodwill is higher? Is purely because of valuation of NCI. You see, earlier NCI is valued at 400, now valued at 480, so it's increased by 80, and this is also 150 to 230 increased by 80. So effectively, what is goodwill, my dear friends? A difference between what you pay, what I receive. The difference is what we call as goodwill. When I pay more, it is attributable towards goodwill. Because in the book value, goodwill will not be there. But when I make a payment, goodwill will be there. Understood the point? So when I'm valuing the NCI on proportionate basis, I'm doing it on book value basis basically, right? So when you value it on book value basis, that will not include goodwill. Please observe this valuation. You'll understand very clearly. This 750 is amount paid by holding company, purchase consideration. This will include a value of goodwill, because when I'm making a payment, includes a value of goodwill. But NCI, I'm taking proportionate of net assets, that is book value, that does not include goodwill. And therefore, this 150, which is only part of 750 relating to holding company share. Whereas when I'm valuing fair value method, this 750 is in market value terms. And this NCI is there, no, that 480 is also in market value terms, which means 750 also includes goodwill, 480 also includes goodwill. Are you able to understand? 750 also includes goodwill, 480 also includes goodwill. So if I have to break it up, how do I break it up? I hope you have taken down till here. If I write it like this, on a fair value method, okay, on a fair value method, holding company share and outsider share, NCI share, okay, what is the book value and what is the fair value? If I divide like this, a holding company share, total of the company's assets is 1000. Holding company share is 60%, which is 600. NCI share 40%, which is 400, right? 60%, 40%. And what is the investment made by holding company? Investment made by holding company is 750. Therefore, goodwill related to holding company share is 150. And what is the fair value of NCI? That is 480. So, 80 is goodwill related to NCI holding. So, ultimately, 230 is the goodwill of the company, goodwill of the subsidiary. 1000 minus 1000, 230. The difference, that's what you call as goodwill. So, this 1000 is, when you calculate it based on this 150, that is proportionate method. And 230, that is fair value method. Fair value method. Okay. So, you please take down this also. And let's pause journal entry. And ultimately, I will write the solution in my format. Okay, hope you have taken down. Let us just pause the journal entry. Okay. Let me do in a columnar method for easy convenience. In exam, don't do columnar method journal entry, pass separate journal entry. So, proportionate method and fair value method. Fair value method is also called as full value of goodwill because it includes goodwill of both the owners. Fair value method. So, debit what comes in, credit what you pay. What is coming in? Net identifiable assets. And this ownership is made up of two things. Two, the payment you make to cash, that is basically purchase consideration paid by holding company. And two, NCI, the ownership, outsider's ownership in the subsidiary company. And balancing figure, that becomes goodwill. And we already calculated here. Net identifiable assets is 1000. Goodwill under proportionate method, we calculated 150. To cash, the purchase consideration, 750. And NCI proportionately 400. Under fair value method, net identifiable asset is 1000. Goodwill is 230. To cash is 750 and NCI is 480. So you can see the difference in goodwill arising because of the difference in NCI. So we have written, so in proportionate method, goodwill only relates to holding company share, but in fair value method, goodwill relates to holding company share as well as goodwill related to NCI share. Okay. Hope you have taken down. Okay. Now I'll prepare in this format. This format logic part I'm not explaining much now. I hope you would have already learned by now. Three columnar format I'll go. I mean, apart from particulars and amounts, we will have goodwill within brackets. Then we have ConPL. To be specific, it is actually other equity because it comprises of all reserve surplus and NCI. This is the format we follow. So first we'll do subsidiary company heading. What we take from their books of accounts, and then I'll take from holding company heading what I take from their books of accounts. So subsidiary companies, I will write share capital and reserves and surplus which come from subsidiary company balance sheets. NCI or MI, which term is appropriate as per ICAI material? NCI only. In Ind AS, we don't use the word MI. Minority interest is the word we use in AS world. In Ind AS, it's purely NCI. That's why we are using NCI everywhere. As per Ind AS, it is NCI. So subsidiary company, we write under the share capital and reserves and surplus, which is nothing but net identifiable assets. And holding company, which I write it as whatever investment in subsidiary. Okay, so net identifiable asset is, so you should write amount is thousands, right? Holding company share is 60%, that will go to goodwill column. So 60% holding company share. If you have any post acquisition profit, that is going to ConPL. NCI, that is remaining 40%. So 60% goes to goodwill column, which is 600. Nothing goes to ConPL, 400 goes to NCI. Nothing, no post acquisition profits, so nothing to be concerned about it. Investment in subsidiary, we are having 750, right? Yeah, 750 within brackets. So on the asset items, I'm writing it in negative numbers within brackets. Liability items, I'm writing in positive numbers. So 750. Nothing here, and you can see now what do I get. So in the log column, whatever the net total amount I get, 150 negative number, right? Negative number I get. So in this case, in my method, in this system, if negative number comes, goodwill, because I'm doing plus minus opposite as compared to the previous one. You understand, right? Net identifiable asset I'm doing plus, investment I'm doing minus. So just be careful about the plus minus method between the format which I followed previously, which institute follows, and which in our full-fledged problem what we follow. Just be aware of that. So in this case, that's why I've written heading goodwill within brackets. So in this calculation, if negative number comes, that is goodwill. And that's what we got, goodwill. This is goodwill. Don't worry about NCI total. We are not solving full-fledged problem. But if it is a fair value method, okay. Now, what we did now, as it is, this will give you automatic answer on proportionate method. When you follow this, this will give you answer on proportionate method in my format. Automatically, the answer comes in proportionate method. But if you want to move from proportionate method to fair value method, can you tell me what is the differentiating factor? What is the differentiating factor which moves from proportionate method to fair value method? That is the way you value NCI, right? So NCI, here we valued fair value or proportionate method. You move it to fair value method. That difference is what causing the difference in goodwill. Difference in NCI is the difference in goodwill. So when you want to follow fair value method, what I'm going to do, I call something as NCI adjustment. NCI adjustment, and that is going to be difference between book value and fair value, right? Now 400 is book value because it's book value, out of the book value of the we have taken. And what is the fair value of NCI? Fair value of NCI is given as 230. Or 480. Fair value is taken as 480. So what is the incremental amount? The increase in the fair value we require 80, right? And that is what I call it as a fair value adjustment, NCI adjustments. That is, NCI adjustment is a fair value 480 minus book value 400. That's the difference from proportionate method to fair value method. At what I'm going to do, I'm going to, the difference, whatever number I get, I'm going to add in NCI, that 80, this 80, I'm going to add in NCI and subtract in goodwill column. Why I'm adding in NCI? Because NCI fair value is high, NCI should increase. Why I'm subtracting in goodwill column? Because my goodwill should increase, but my goodwill is within brackets. That is negative number. So that should increase means that also should be negative number. So that is the logic behind it. But what you remember simply, the fair value difference, the incremental fair value, you add in NCI, subtract in goodwill. If fair value is less, do reverse. You add in goodwill, subtract in NCI. Very simple concept. If fair value of NCI is high, you add in NCI, subtract in goodwill. If fair value of NCI is less than the book value, you subtract in NCI, you add in goodwill. Just the two treatment possible. Okay. So hope you have taken down. This is the format discussion, joint discussion, as well as the goodwill calculation. Okay, I'll go further. Okay. X Limited acquires 80% of Y Limited by paying cash consideration of 400 lakhs. The fair value of non-controlling interest on the date of acquisition is 100 lakhs. The value of subsidiaries net identifiable asset is 103 is 520 lakhs. Determine the value of gain on bargain purchase and pass the journal entry. Have they given which method here? Okay, so let's follow both the methods. Now this I will not discuss in detail. Hope you're already aware of the format. So I just follow the institute format quickly, because for the simple problem like this, I don't recommend my method, because my method is slightly lengthier in my opinion, but will save time in a full-fledged problem. Just to compute the goodwill of bargain purchase, let's follow the simple columnar method. So proportionate method and fair value method. So three simple lines, whatever the purchase consideration paid, PC paid, that is cost of investment, plus NCI valuation minus net identifiable assets. Simple concept. So purchase consideration paid, 400 lakhs, NCI. In proportionate method, you take proportionate of net assets. Net identifiable asset is 520 lakhs. And this proportionate 80% is holding company share, 20% is NCI's share, so 20% of 520. You get negative number 16, which means in our method we would have got positive number, but here negative method means it's not goodwill but capital reserve. But here we use the term gain on bargain purchase, because when you pay less, it's a benefit you have made, you paid less, gain on bargain purchase. 16. Fair value method, PC paid is 400. NCI, I don't take proportionately, I take fair value directly, and fair value is 100. And the net identifiable asset is 520. So we get negative number 20, which means gain on bargain purchase 20. In our method, remember, you would have got a positive number if I follow our columnar method. Okay, I'll go further. Oh, journal entry is there. Journal entry, let's pass. Journal entry. I'll pass two separate entries here. You can make columnar for a class convenience, but I will pass two separate entries. So one entry, what is coming in? Net identifiable asset. Okay, let's proportionate method. I'll give that in. Proportionate method. Net identifiable assets, asset coming in, goodwill is not there, so gain bargain purchase, 2 NCI, 2 purchase consideration or 2 cash, 2 gain on bargain purchase. Gain on bargain purchase. So net identifiable asset is 520. NCI proportionate 104. Cash 400. And gain on bargain purchase 16. Similarly, fair value method. Net identifiable assets, two NCI, two cash, two gain on bargain purchase. Net identifiable asset 520, NCI valuation different, hundreds. Cash same 400 and gain on bargain purchase 20. Okay, fine. I'll go next. M Limited acquires 100% of N Limited by paying a cash consideration of 100 lakhs. The value of subsidiaries net entity balance sheet as per Ind AS 103 is 80 lakhs. Determine the value of goodwill. So 100 lakh is the PC. Purchase consideration 100 lakhs. NCI. What is NCI here? Zero, right? Because no outsiders are there. Zero. Minus net identifiable assets, which is 80. And therefore, goodwill is 20. And can you tell me, this goodwill is under proportionate method or this goodwill under fair value method? The answer is does not matter, because the method differs because of valuation of NCI. NCI only not there, wholly owned subsidiary, fully owned subsidiary, NCI valuation only not there, which means the question of proportionate method, fair value method itself do not arise. The difference will arise only because of valuation of NCI. NCI only not there, method does not matter. Okay, next. RS Limited holds 30% stake in PQ Limited. This investment in PQ Limited is accounted as an investment in accordance with Ind AS 28, carrying a value of such investment in 100 lakhs. RS Limited purchases remaining 70% stake for a cash consideration of 700 lakhs. The fair value of previously 30% held is measured to be 300 lakhs. On the rate of acquisition of 70% stake, the value of PQ Limited's identifiable net assets as per Ind AS 103 on the debt is 800 lakhs. How should RS Limited account for the business combination? Okay, so first I'll show you the calculation part, then I'll show the journal entry also for your reference. Okay, what is the format? Remember what we used to follow, and here also the question of fair value method or proportionate method do not arise, because you have earlier 30% stake already and you acquired 70% stake. So this is a case of fully owned subsidiary. NCA do not exist. So method does not matter. But anyway, the format is this. We always say, right, whatever the PC paid by holding company plus NCI, if you value it on proportionate method, goodwill is proportionate method. If you value NCI on fair value method, goodwill is fair value method. So NCI you add, in this case zero, minus net identifiable asset. Okay, this is the broad format. Now in PC paid by holding company, there are two acquisitions. First acquisition you already made, and second acquisition you are making now. First acquisition is 30% where you not got the control, so you would not have done the consolidation then. And second acquisition you are acquiring 70%, NCI is 0%. So how much amount of net identifiable asset you have? Net identifiable asset on the date of acquisition is 800 lakhs. 800 lakhs. PC paid by first acquisition, second acquisition, what you're paying now, you're acquiring 70% for a stake of 700 lakhs. So this you're going to account it 700 lakhs. Now this 30% fair value is 300 lakhs. This is fair value. But the cost which you acquired when you acquired initially, or the book value, is 100 lakhs. Your book value is 100 lakhs, but fair value is 300 lakhs. So you have to recognize a profit, which we call it as other equity. But anyway, you first you compute this, then I'll show you a journal entry, you'll understand better. So what you should do when you're already having an investment, which we call it as previously held equity, the 30% already held, previously held, that should be valued on fair value basis on the date of acquisition of control. So goodwill comes to $200. And this difference should go to P&L. The difference between cost and fair value should go to P&L. Okay, anyway, I'll pass journal entry, you'll understand it. Let me pass journal entry. Hope you've taken down. I'll write journal entry in the next slide. Okay, next slide, I'll write. So journal entry going to be normal journal entry for goodwill, you know, for acquisition, which is net identifiable asset coming in, goodwill account debit, amount paid to cash, to NCI. This is the normal format, right? Now, net identifiable asset in this case is 800. Goodwill is 200. Now, this is a trick. To cash is 700. NCI is 0, I think. Okay, nothing. NCI is 0. But 100% is not represented here. What 100% not represented here? Please observe. NCI, 0%, nothing. What cash you're paying is 70%. What about 30% ownership? You already have. 30% ownership you already have. So we will, and you already have. So I don't write as to cash. I've already paid earlier. So again, I don't write to cash. It's already in my books. And what I'm going to write? To investments already held. This is the cost of investments already held. Cost of investments already held, already paid. Already held, already paid. And what is cost of investments? Cost of investment is 100, right? In the books of account, it's showing 100. But while valuing goodwill, we have now taken cost of investment into consideration. We have taken fair value into consideration. So what is the fair value? 300. So 100 should become 300, means that 200 is the profit and loss. So to P&L or other equity, you can say. So to gain on revaluation of previously held equity. Effectively goes to P&L, that is ultimately go to other equity. So when entity already has an previously held equity, it should be revalued with the fair value, and fair value is relevant for goodwill determination. Difference between cost and fair value, you take it to P&L or other equity. Okay, I'll go further. So one of the comment I'm getting, method is helpful for an exam. Very good. That is the objective. As long as it is making kind of some value addition, my effort is justified. Okay, let me go further. Okay, next one. A Limited, which is involved in the business of selling capital equipment. A parent company sold equipment costing 100 lakhs to 80% of subsidiary B Limited at 120 lakhs. So A Limited, the holding company, sold a capital equipment to B Limited subsidiary. At 120 lakhs. So sale value 120 lakhs and holding company has 80% stake in subsidiary company. The capital equipment recorded as PPE by B Limited. B Limited has taken as PPE. Useful life of PPE on the date was on the date of transfer was 10 years. Okay, so useful life 10 years. Show the necessary adjustments in consolidation of financial statements. Costing 100. Okay, sale value 120. Costing 100. Okay, so book value is 100, but sold at 120. Okay, fine. Okay, what should be done here? Okay. Now, what A Limited would have passed an entry, let's understand. I'll just try to show it. In holding company books, what you would have done? In A Limited books. A Limited books. They would have recognized a revenue, right? They would have recognized the revenue of 120 and their cost of goods sold 100. Relevant for this transaction, I'm telling. And profit, they have recognized 20. This is in A Limited books. In B Limited books, they would have recognized asset PPE of 120 and they have recognized depreciation over a useful life of on the date of transfer was 10 years. Let's say I'm doing it at the end of the year when the transfer not given. Let's say I'll do it at the end of the year. So depreciation. They would have charged how much? 120 divided by 10 years. It would have been 12. Okay, fine. So 120 divided by 10, 12. This is in B Limited books. Okay, this is in A books already passed, and B limited books already recognized. Now, when I'm consolidating, in consolidated books, what should happen? Now, should that revenue, is it a revenue? For A limited, is it, it is a revenue. For, is it for a group a revenue? Are you selling outside the group? It is not a revenue. So, revenue should be derecognized. So, I'm going to do consolidated revenue account. I'm going to derecognize. And how much? It is going to be 120. I will derecognize. Then cost of goods sold also I will remove. Cost of goods sold would be debit and I will credit to cost of goods sold, 100. Effectively, can I say profit which was recognized earlier, I am now removing it. Unrealized profit is now removed by way of this amount. 20 profit is unrealized. And where will be the credit goes to basically? It would have been this profit amount would have been included in PPE. So I will write 2 PPE. How much I should write? Normally I need to write 2 PPE as 20. But at the end of the year, you would have charged depreciation also on this amount. How much depreciation would have charged on this unrealized profit amount? It would have been 20 divided by 10. Which is 2, right? So it would not be 20, it would be only remaining 18. And 2 depreciation, which is 2. Effectively, PPE 120. And that is being adjusted for 100 adjusted in cost of goods sold, 18 adjusted in PPE, and 2 adjusted in depreciation. What is the 2 calculation? I'll tell you once more. Unrealized profit is 20, right? This, if you allocate over whatever the life, and then in that case, 20 divided by 10 years, at the end of the year, you would have already charged depreciation 2 rupees. I will say you would have charged excess depreciation 2 rupees. So entry will be consolidated revenue, 2 COGS, 2 PPE, 2 depreciation. And basically, remember, in our full-fledged problems, if it comes, this profit element is a pre-acquisition profit because it's arising on the date of acquisition. Mostly, I don't know when they're sold. I assume it is sold on the date of acquisition. I mean, if sold on acquisition, if sold before acquisition, then it is pre-acquisition. And then depreciation comes later. So this depreciation to what we have would be post-acquisition. Of course, if sold after acquisition, this profit also is post-acquisition. Anyway, so in the full-fledged problems, you should be able to understand how to apply. So remaining PPE will continue. Okay, how much remaining PPE will continue? You had recognized 120 PPE. Now you charge depreciation 12. So what would be the PPE in the balance sheet? 120 minus depreciation 12. Then you are adding back 18. So plus 18. So how much it going to be? 120 minus 12 plus 18. So 120 minus 18. Sorry, minus 18. 120 minus depreciation 12, and you're subtracting 18, not adding, minus, you're subtracting 18. So 120 minus 12 minus 18, 90. And what is effectively the 90 comes to? 100 is the cost. My depreciation, if you provide over 10 years, 100 minus 10, 90. That's the 90 it comes to. Hope you're able to connect everything. Had you continued at cost, what would have been your depreciation and what would have been your amount of PP? That's what we are reflecting. Okay, fine. Next. MN Limited was holding 80% stake in UV Limited. Now, MN Limited has disposed of the entire stake in UV Limited in two different transactions as follows. So, transaction 1, 25% stake for a consideration of 2,50,000. And transaction 2, 55% stake for a cash consideration of 5,50,000. Both the transactions have happened within a period of 1 month. In accordance with the guidance given in Ind AS 110, both the transactions are to be accounted as single transaction. The net assets of UV Limited and non-controlling interest on the date of both the transactions was 9 lakh and 1,80,000 respectively, assuming there were no earnings between the period of transactions, how MN Limited should account the transaction. Okay, fine. So both are happening in the same year. And initially you had 80%. Then you lose the 25%. That means balance became 55%. And 50% also you lose, then it became 0%. And they only said you have to account as a single transaction because it happens within the same year. Now we'll account as a single transaction. The question here is this. This is about disposal. In disposal, there are two situations possible. When you dispose, you lose the control. When you dispose, you don't lose the control. That is the premise based on which this problem is asked. So when you have 80% and you take out 25%, you still have 55%. You still have 55%. Does it mean you have control or not? Do you retain control or have you lost control? Yeah. Based on this, we can say they retain control. But you know, in Ind AS, I always tell there might be other facts and circumstances beyond just voting power. Voting power is significant, no doubt. But we have to consider other factors also. So, we will discuss this in a situational manner. In the sense, two situations I've discussed. In the exam, you can show one is sufficient. If first transaction results in loss of control. Or let's say not results, if the first transaction not results in loss of control, which is typical one because you still have 55%, you can see you still have control. Okay. So what is going to be the journal entry? Let's understand directed journal entry. So when you acquired, net asset came in, goodwill came in, 2 NCI, 2 cash you did. Now when you sell, everything reverse. Goodwill going out, net assets going out, those kind of things. Okay, but if it is not resulting in loss of control, your control is not lost. Which means control is not lost in the first, but lost in the second. Which means implies control is lost in the second transaction. Control lost in second disposal, in second transaction. Okay. So what you, when you receive some money, we are going to account it as advance. This 2,50,000 received. Ideally, we should recognize an other equity, profit or loss on sale, but in regular problems. But here it's happening in the same year. So the 25% received is taken as advance. The first transaction. That is bank 2,50,000 to advance received 2,50,000. You are not doing anything on the first acquisition because first acquisition control retained, control is not lost. So no other derecognition. On the second transaction, now the control is lost, so you can derecognize. So it's going to be bank amount received 5,50,000, advance received 2,50,000, NCI share I don't know. Oh, given net assets given, NCI share given is 1,80,000. So NCI share 1,80,000 to net assets derecognized. Net assets on the date of sale 9 lakh. Oh, goodwill, we don't have any information on goodwill. Let's assume this includes goodwill. Then 2. The balancing figure will be profit or loss on the disposal. So gain on disposal. ₹5,50,000 plus ₹2,50,000 plus ₹1,80,000 minus ₹9,80,000. Gain on disposal to be recognized in P&L. Consolidated P&L. 80,000. Okay, very good. This is if first transaction not resulting in loss of control, which means control is lost in the second transaction. I'll go for the other method now. If control is lost in first transaction itself, which means the exact same entry what I have passed in second transaction, I'll do it on the first transaction itself. How it's on the first transaction, so one more point I should have added here. So consolidation is derecognized or stopped or terminated from second acquisition here, because control is lost in second acquisition. consolidation is terminated from second acquisition. Okay. Here, if control is lost in first transaction, same entry I'll pass, but on the first transaction itself. First transaction itself, I'll pass the entry. How much? Bank 2,50,000. But 5,50,000 is not received yet. I'm going to receive in the second transaction. So I cannot write bank here. I will write like a receivable. Receivable amount. 5,50,000. Then NCI. 1,80,000. To net identifiable assets. 9,00,000. To gain on disposal, same, 80,000. And second transaction we are going to do, you actually receive that money. So the entry will be bank account 5,50,000 to receivable entry, what we have written, that you close it now, to receivable 5,50,000. And because control is lost in first transaction, consolidation is terminated. The entity stops doing consolidation from first transaction itself. Consolidation is terminated from first transaction itself. First transaction itself. Anyway, so this is a set of journal entries depending on two interpretations possible. Okay, I'll go further. A Limited ceased to be an investment entity from 1st of April 2011, on which date it was holding 80% of B Limited. You know, investment entity means consolidation need not be done, but they should do valuation on fair value basis. The carrying, but it ceases to be investment entity now. So going forward, you have to do consolidation because you're not investment entity. Exemption don't apply. Consolidation to be done. The carrying value of such investments in B Limited, which was measured at fair value through P&L, was 4,00,000. The fair value of non-controlling interest on the date of change in status was 1,00,000. The carrying value of such investment is 4,00,000. Fair value of non-controlling interest, okay, remaining 20%, 1,00,000. The value of subsidiaries net identifiable asset as per Ind AS 103 is 4,50,000 on the date of change in status. Determine the value of goodwill and pass the entries on the date of change in such entity, investment entity. Assume non-controlling interest is measured on fair value method. Okay, this is much simpler. We are having investments that will be taken out. Instead, you will replace it by a subsidiary company. In the sense, remember the regular journal entry what we used to pass on acquisition day? Journal entry on acquisition. We used to pass entries like net identifiable asset coming in, goodwill coming in, to cash, to NCI, right? That's what we used to follow. Now here, I don't write to cash. Instead to cash, I'll write to investments. Because I've already paid the amount long time back. So find out the balancing figure. That's all. Very simple. So investments, fair value of investment is 4 lakh. NCI, valued on fair value basis, is 1 lakh. Net identifiable asset is 4,50,000. Balancing fair goodwill, I think 50,000. Goodwill, balancing figure, that's all the answer. Nothing great. Your investment entity, so you are showing only investments. Now you are ceasing to be investing entity. Therefore, investment is de-recognized, investment is closed, and subsidiary is recognized. That is, their assets is replacing investment. Investment is taken out and replaced by the assets and liabilities of subsidiary, which means consolidation process begins. Okay, that's all about this problem. CD Limited purchased 100% subsidiary for 20 lakh on 31st March 2001 when the fair value of net assets was 16 lakh. So goodwill is straightforward 4 lakh. Therefore, goodwill is 4 lakh. Oh, they only told. CD becomes an investment entity. Oh, now it's reverse. You are doing consolidation earlier. Now it becomes investment entity when the carrying value of investments measured at fair value through P&L was 25 lakh. On the date of change in status, carrying value of net assets and KL Limited excluding goodwill was 19 lakh. Calculate the gain or loss with respect to investments on the date of change in investment entity status of CD Limited. So earlier, in consolidation now, we used to represent subsidiary company's net assets and non-controlling interest, if any, nothing here. Now that net assets will be taken out and investments will be replaced, because going forward, you becomes an investment entity. Investment entity need not do consolidation. So in your consolidated books, you don't show subsidiaries' assets as your assets. That is, you de-recognize the net assets and you de-recognize the goodwill and you recognize the fair value of investments. So what entry you are going to pass? On the date of derecognition, disposal, change in status, I'll say derecognition. You became an investment entity means you no longer have to do consolidation. So consolidation should be derecognized, should not be done. So goodwill, you credit, reverse to goodwill. NCI, if any, you debit to net identifiable assets. To net identifiable asset, you derecognize. Okay, you take it out, you derecognize. We used to write cash. If you're selling for cash, we used to debit cash, but instead of cash, I will debit investments. And if you have any NCI, I used to do NCI. But in this case, 0% NCI, so nothing to worry about. Goodwill, they only have given 4 lakh. Net identifiable asset on the date of sale, excluding goodwill, was 19 lakh. But the fair value of investment is 25 lakh. So what will happen to the balance 2 lakh? It's a gain that you have to recognize. So we are going to do 2. Gain on disposal, 2 lakh. Understanding, right? Your net assets, assets and liabilities of subsidiary you are showing as part of your holding, your company, 19 lakh. Goodwill you are showing 4 lakh. So effective book value 23 lakh. But I'm selling for 25 lakh. So 23 lakh sold for 25. 2 lakh is my profit. But I'm not receiving cash. So we are not debiting cash. Instead, I'm debiting investments. Going forward, consolidation not done. This investment will be carried on fair value basis. Fine. Hope you understood. Okay, I'll go further. Okay. So now we are going to do full-fledged problem. This is January 2021 question, which came for 15 marks, which is actually very simple one if you follow my system. One new adjustment came in, but if you knew the concept, you could have done in my system. But anyway, I'll show you in this problem how to do that. On April 1st, 2017, A Limited acquired 80% of share capital of S Limited. On the acquisition date, capital and reserves of S Limited stood at 5 lakh and 1,25,000 respectively. A Limited paid initial cash consideration of 10 lakhs. Additionally, A Limited issued 2 lakh shares with a nominal value of 1 per share, at a current market value of 1.8 per share. It was also agreed that A Limited would pay further sum of 5 lakh after 3 years. A Limited's cost of capital is 10%, appropriate discounting factor for Rupee 1 at 10%, receivable at the end of first year, second year, third year given. The shares and deferred considerations have not yet been recorded by A Limited. Below are the balance sheets of A Limited and S Limited on 31st March 2019. A Limited's, B Limited's given, non-current assets, plant property equipment, investments at cost. Investments, they have given 1,000, which is 1,000 in heading 1,000. 1,000 means 10 lakhs, which is cash consideration. But apart from cash consideration, you also have issued shares. And apart from cash consideration, you agreed for 5 lakh after 3 years. But these two are not yet recorded. We have to record. So when you record, what will happen? Share capital issued will increase, investments will increase. Similarly, deferred consideration, a liability will increase, and the investment cost will increase. Inventory, receivables, cash, share capital, retained earnings, non-current liability, current liabilities. Okay. Further information. On the date of acquisition, the fair value of S Limited's plant exceeded its book value by 2 lakh. The plant had a remaining useful life of 5 years at this date. Consolidated goodwill has been impaired by 2,50,000. A Limited's group values non-controlling interest using fair value method. On the date of acquisition, the fair value of 20% non-controlling interest is 3,80,000. You're required to prepare consolidated balance sheet, notes to accounts is not required. Very good. Anyway, we are not preparing it, but anyway, very simplest problem that you can solve beautifully in the system I follow. So you can read the problem once more. Okay, fine. So let us prepare regular formats. Then we'll do some more adjustments, working note, whatever required. Okay. So particulars, amount, goodwill within brackets, con PL, which is actually means other equity, and then NCI. We'll start from subsidiary. And then we'll go to holding company. Basic structure and percentage. They acquired on 1st of April 80%, and balance sheet is given on 31st March 19, oh, after 2 years they have given. No problem. 80%. So 80% is holding company share. 80% is holding company share. 25% is NCI share. Okay. Let me start with the basic thing. That is, subsidiary company, what we should take? Subsidiary company, look at the liability side. Their share capital, their retained earnings. Let's try to focus only on that first. Share capital, 500. And their retained earnings. They said 300 that they have given. 500, 300 they have given. But out of retained earnings 300, please observe, on the date of acquisition, the share capital is 5 lakh. Share capital is 5 lakh, that is same. But reserves were 125. So what do you understand by this reserves, my dear friend? 125 was already there on the date of acquisition. So can I say 125 is a pre-acquisition and balance 175 is earned after the date of acquisition, which is post-acquisition. Simple enough to understand. 300 as on the date of balance sheet. 125,000 was there when you acquired. These are all rupees in thousands. So out of 300,000, 125 was there already. Balance 125 was earned during the current, earned after acquisition. So 125 is pre, 175 is post. So please check, are you able to understand these calculations? You are fine, right? Till here? Okay. Very good. So, these adjustments we have done. And they said, the shares have not yet been recorded by A Limited. The shares issued have not been recorded. And the deferred consideration also, they have not yet recorded. So, let's discuss the adjustments by way of journal entry. If they were to record those two things, what would have happened? Right? Let me show it to you. You see, A Limited, right? And B Limited. Okay. So, A Limited, from B Limited, all the business gone. A Limited acquired the business, 80% shareholding. 80% shareholding, whatever, 80% shares. And against which, A Limited issued what and all they have given as purchase consideration. They have given cash. They have given shares and they have promised to pay some amount after some years, I think after 3 years. Cash have been recorded, shares have not been recorded, promise to pay have not been recorded. So let's understand what entry we have to pass for those aspects. So when you issue shares, what entry to be passed? It will be in the books of holding company, okay, in the books of A Limited. It is investments account. To cash, I need not do it because to cash they've already done. But what additional thing I should do? To share capital. To, if it is issued above face value, have they given the fair value? Fair current value 1.8 per share. Yes, that means security premium. To security premium. And to deferred consideration. consideration payable. What do we call that? Deferred consideration. Okay, let's call it to deferred consideration. Consideration payable. To cash, we already done it. This is the additional entry to be passed. Investment to cash is already done, right? So what is the amount you have to write down? How many shares are issued? 2 lakh shares. Face value 1, market value 1.8. So 2 lakh into 1. 2 lakh is share capital. 2 lakh into 0.8. 1,60,000 is security premium. And consideration payable. Deferred consideration. How much payable? 5 lakh. After 3 years, you should apply discounting factor of 5 lakh into 0.75. $375,000 So this is the amount of investments additional. They have not recorded. Please add 375 plus 160 plus 200. 735,000 is the investment that they need to recognize additionally. So in our format, when I'm writing investments under holding company, existing investments I take, this unrecorded value also to be recorded and to be recognized. 735,000. Hope you are able to get this one. This is on the date of acquisition and subsequently. They have to recognize this consideration payable is done on present value basis. On this, there has to be unwinding of discount. Basically, we have to calculate interest on consideration payable, which means we need to take this to P&L account, right? Holding company's P&L account. So you are going to pass, and 2 years have elapsed. The acquisition took place on 1/4/2017. And we are writing on 31st March 2000, acquisition took place on 1/4/17. We are writing on 31st March 2019. So 2 years have elapsed. So you have to do unwinding of discount. Recognize interest basically. Unwinding of discount on 31st of March 2018, first year, what entry are going to pass? Interest basically goes to P&L account. So I'll say directly P&L to consideration payable. Or I'll write in the next slide. I'll write this next slide so that it becomes more neater. Hope you have taken down till here. Okay, so go to the next slide. So A Limited, after acquisition, they should do unwinding of discount. Unwinding of discount. They should charge interest to consideration payable, 31st March 2018. I mean, the exam, you don't have to show journal entries. I'm showing you for your reference. You understand for that purpose. Interest account debit to consideration payable. We have recognized the 375. Interest is 10%. That means 37,500. and interest goes to P&L, holding company P&L. And 31/3/2019, again interest, that is, goes to P&L. But can you tell me now this time on what amount will you calculate? Will you calculate on 375,000? Second year, on 31/3/2019, will you calculate 10% interest on same 375,000? What do you think? On which amount will you calculate? On which amounts will you calculate the interest on a compounding basis basically? Okay, as usual, no response. Okay, no problem. Let me answer it. On a compounding basis, when you charge interest, you have to add on cumulative amount. So on 375,000 plus 37,500 you do, because interest was added in the previous year, on that you apply 10%. You keep accumulating it. $41,250 to consideration payable. $41,250. Okay, so this is the entry which A Limited, the holding company, have not passed, so they have to pass additionally. Okay, let's go back to the question. What is required? Shares have not been recorded, we have recorded. Deferred consideration not recorded, we have recorded. Okay, I think let's just with the format. Okay, let's continue with the format here. 80% goes to goodwill column, that is 400. 20% goes to NCI, which is 100. Pre-acquisition, same treatment. 80%, 125 into 80%, 100 goes to goodwill column. 25 goes to NCI column. Post-acquisition, you take it to ConPL column. That's all the difference. So 175 into 80%, 140 goes to ConPL, 35 goes to NCI. Simple. So we have done with the share capital and retained earnings piece of subsidiary company. Let's look at adjustments one by one. On the date of acquisition, fair value of S Limited's plan exceeded the book value by 4 lakh. Basically, revaluation gain is a pre-acquisition profit. You can say fair value adjustment, or in I used to say revaluation profit. Revaluation profit. Revaluation profit 200,000. I mean, so we are doing it in 1,000. So I'll write 200. Remember, pre-acquisition profit, because it is taking place on the date of acquisition. So 200, 80%, that comes to 160. So you should take it in goodwill column, because it is taking place on the date of acquisition. And balance 20%, NCI 40. And whenever revaluation comes, a depreciation has to follow. A revaluation profit means depreciation minus depreciation within brackets. Depreciation, the life of the machine is 5 years. So out of which 2 years are over. So you should do 200 divided by 5 into 2. Spread across 5 years. So after acquisition, 2 years are over. So that will become 80, I think, within brackets. And this is post because when revaluation is profit, depreciation is minus. So 80%, right? Okay. 64 within brackets goes to ConPL and balance 16 goes to NCI. So we have done with this adjustment. Impairment, I will take at the last piece. When I do the holding company, I'll take the impairment. A Limited Group values the non-controlling interest on the date of acquisition, fair value 20%. So they're valuing it on fair value basis. When NCI is valued on fair value basis in our format, what is required? Fair value adjustment, which is difference between book value and fair value. So NCI adjustment, I will say, NCI adjustment. NCI adjustment, fair value is given as 380,000. What is book value coming to? What and all you should take for book value? We'll take share capital on the date of acquisition. Retained earnings on the date of acquisition. So 25 you take, 35 you don't take. After acquisition you don't take. Revaluation profit you take. Depreciation revaluation profit don't take. So these are the elements which are part of pre-acquisition. So 100 plus 25 plus 40. I think 165. So what is the difference then? Book value minus fair value. Adjustments what we require. 380 minus 165. 215. So in fair value is high. In NCI we add 215. And in goodwill I subtract 215. NCI adjustment. Okay, so that is it with respect to subsidiary company heading. We'll come to holding company. The most crucial one, holding company, is investments. What is investments in holding company? If you take only the balance sheet, it will be investments 1,000. But you should not in only 1,000. You should also take 1,000 plus the 735,000. Because they are not recorded. We have to record. So how much will be, it comes to? 1,000 investments plus 735,000, which means 735. Unrecorded. We have to record now. 1735. This will be subtracted in goodwill column. 1735 will be subtracted in goodwill column. Okay, what else? Holding company's retained earnings. Okay, is 1,400. So retained earnings, 1,400. But some more things we have to account here. What are those? One is security premium. Because they are not recorded. We have passed the general entry separately, right? Security premium, 1,60,000. The share capital will be added to holding company share capital. Consideration payable will come in non-current liabilities. We'll take it up later, or current liabilities. Share capital, we'll take it later. Security premium, 1,60,000. 160. That I will take it to the holding company's P&L. Basically, I can add it to 1,400. Holding company's P&L. And from holding company's P&L, what and have we have done? Unwinding of interest. So this P&L debit, we have to reduce. Right? So that should be done. Unwinding of interest. Interest on deferred consideration. Interest on deferred consideration. I don't have space to add it. You please add it up. 37,500 plus 41,250. Right? 37,500 plus 41,250, 78,750. I'll try 78.75 because rupees in thousands. 78.75. And impairment of goodwill. Impairment of goodwill. How much goodwill impairment? Impaired by 2,58,000. 2,58,000 is the total amount. But to whom it should be allocated goodwill? This impairment should be allocated to both holding company and NCI because we are valuing on NCI basis. So 1258 goodwill gets reduced, means I'll do plus in goodwill. And Con PL share, NCI share, holding company share, NCI share. 258 into 80%, 206.4. And NCI share, 51.6. This is allocated to both the columns because impairment, I mean, because goodwill is recognized on fair value basis. Had you followed the goodwill on proportionate basis, the entire goodwill would have gone to Con PL column, which is holding company share, because NCI share would not have been recognized then. So when goodwill is not recognized, impairment also will not be recognized for NCI when you follow proportionate method. But when you follow fair value method, goodwill relates to holding company also, goodwill relates to NCI share also. So when you recognize goodwill, you respected both. When you impair goodwill, both should take the hit. Hope you get that logic. So you can do the total investments we have done, reserves we have done. So you can do the total, how much we get. 400 plus 100 plus 160 minus 215 minus 1735 plus 258. Is it 1032 negative, which means goodwill? And here 140 minus 64 plus 1400 plus 160 plus 78.75 minus 206.4. Oh, sorry. This interest should be subtracted. 78.75, interest should be subtracted, not added. It's an expense. 1350.85. I think that's what you're getting. 1350.85. NCI. I think 347.4. So, hope you have done the full-fledged column, full-fledged working note format. We just had to prepare balance sheet, which is a matter of 5-10 minutes. 5 minutes maximum, actually. So, goodwill 1032. Con PL 1350.85. NCI 347.6. Okay, hope you have done till here. Any doubts? Can you help me in making concepts strong? As I told you, these are upgradation classes. On the conceptual piece, please watch the basics of consolidation available in my YouTube channel. I've discussed the concepts of consolidation in the YouTube lectures. It's available. Okay, I think if not getting any other doubts, I'll go forward. Let's go to balance sheet, consolidate balance sheet. Equity and liabilities. Okay, first we write assets, okay, then we write equity and liabilities. Okay, so under assets, we will have two assets, non-current assets, current assets. Under equity liabilities, we will have equity, non-current liability, current liability. Okay, non-current assets. I will start from fixed assets. PPE. What PPE we have? 5,500 plus 1,500. 5,500 plus 1,500 plus adjustments you do. What adjustment? Revaluation profit to be added, depreciation to be subtracted. So plus 200 minus 80. Plus 200 minus 80. You get 7,120. This is PP. Then intangible assets. Goodwill basically. Working note we have done. 1032. Okay. Then... coming to current assets, we are having three things, ITC, I for inventory, then T for trade receivables, cash and cash equivalents. I think no adjustments required for these things. Inventory, 550 plus 100, directly we'll take. 550 plus 100, 650. Trade receivable. 400 plus 200, 600. Cash and cash equivalent, 200 plus 50, 200 plus 50, 250. Okay, I think that's all the assets side. +7120 plus 1032 plus 650 plus 600 plus 250, 9652. Okay, so equity, we are having share capital only of holding company and other equity that comes from working note. Share capital, not only take holding company share capital here, holding company share capital is 2000, but one share capital they have ignored, that is A Limited issued shares, which we have accounted, right? Share capital, journal entry we have done. 200, that we'll account it now. 2000 plus 200. 2000 plus 200 issued, they have not recorded. Had they recorded, there is no problem, but they have not recorded. So 2200. Other equity working notes 1350.85. You have NCI also. Sorry, I forgot to write. NCI also will come. Then in non-current liability. NCI also working note we have done 347.6. Non-current liabilities 3,400. Now that consideration payable after 3 years, but 2 years over, remaining only 1 year. So I'll show it as current liability, the consideration payable. How much consideration payable? We recognize that initial recognition we have recognized at 375, but we have to add unwinding of interest took place. So 375 plus the two interest. What are the two interest? 37,500, 41,250. 37,500, 41,250. $453.75. And current liabilities, no adjustments. We'll take it as it is. Trade payables, 1,250, 650. I'll just say current liability, so trade payable. 1,250, 650. 1,900. Right, 1,900. So total. So this, 3,400 plus 43.75. Okay, 9,652. 347.4. NCI you get is 347.4. I'm sorry. NCI is 347.4. So 347.4. That's the typing mistake, I mean writing mistake. I think now you get 9,652. So that's it. Balance sheet tallied, including explanation. We could solve the problem in 36 minutes. Without explanation, hardly 20 minutes you can solve. Easy problem. If you have written this exam, lucky students, I would say. Of course, if you follow this system, otherwise you would have been under regular method. Okay, so this is what I mean by the optimal way of solving consolidation. Okay, hope you are able to follow so far. Any doubts on this problem? Okay. As usual, no response. Good. Okay. Fine. So some more prompts are there. We'll take it up in the next sessions. I think the live sessions are not really being used by students, I believe. I will be making a subsequent session as a recorded one, so I can record more and I'll upload. And any doubts you have, you can definitely ask in the Telegram channel. Okay, so subsequent sessions will be a recorded one. Till then, take care. Bye bye.